table right now. But before you leave, make sure to grab one of those stars. And we just want to thank all of our veterans for your service. And obviously, yes. And obviously, on this Memorial Day weekend, we especially remember those who have given their lives for the freedoms that that we have in this nation. I have a few other announcements. Seed to Feed is the garden behind me out there near the ball field. And so all the produce that goes from that garden will go to feed hungry people. John Bowman is in charge of that that garden, and he's looking for some help. So if you'd like to help in the Seed to Feed garden, you can contact the church office or contact John Bowman. Also, we have a vegetable garden, which John is in charge of. And our meditation garden, we're surrounded by gardens today. Our meditation garden to my left is looking beautiful. A big hand to those who have worked on the meditation garden and the renovation. Just especially want to lift up Lisa Meredith and Janet Miller for their work and for their coordination. Where are they? In the back. Thank you so much. Vacation Bible School is June 12th through the 16th, 3 to 5 in the afternoon. Tyler Dew is our next generation coordinator, and Tyler is right over there to my left. If you want to help out with VBS, please see Tyler. You can sign up online, faithumc.com. We'd love to have all the kids, so if you have neighbor kids, grandkids, bring them out to Vacation Bible School June 12th through the 16th. And also because of, in celebration of Memorial Day weekend, the offices are closed tomorrow. But again, it's great having you with us this morning. And as we begin our time of worship, let us begin with a word of prayer. Most gracious God, we do thank you for this nation in which we have been blessed with. But God, I thank you for all of those who have given their lives for the freedoms that we have. I thank you for that sacrifice. Dear God, I thank you for the sacrifice of your Son, that Christ Jesus went to the cross to die for our sins and then 3 days later arose victorious over sin and death. Dear God, we come together in his name to celebrate all that you have done for us. Dear God, we thank you for this time together, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We've also got, if you did not grab a song lyric sheet, we have those at the table. But at this time, if you would just stand, greet those around you, and then remain standing for a time of worship. Thank you. enter a time of prayer, and I have some prayer requests to lift up this morning. Karen Hartzog is dealing with COPD. She was in the hospital. She is now home. She lives with her mom, and her mom, Betty Love, is dealing with COVID, so that's really not a good mix, but please pray for Karen Hartzog as well as Betty Love. Also, Jim Robertson, medical, he's dealing with cancer, but he also fell, was in the hospital for a few days. He is now home, but please pray for Jim and his wife, Pat, as they deal with that new situation. Also, a couple of families to remember, the family of Marv Miller. He's related to Bev Ravline, he passed away. And then also the family of Kelly Nielsen, who had a two-year battle with cancer. She is Dan Carlson's niece. So again, the families of Kelly Nielsen and Marv Miller. I'll just ask, are there any other concerns or joys that anybody has this morning? I may not be able to hear you, but we can try. Any other concerns, joys? Most soon, absolutely. She is home. I can't even see you speaking, but Mosun is home. She was in the hospital dealing with some medical issues, but she is home feeling much better. She also has her daughter from Atlanta with her. But continue to pray for Mosun to get medical, but she's doing much better. Gary?
Ella Hess.
Ella Hess. So please pray for Ella. What's Ella going through?
Well, she's in the emergency room right now. They think she has a staph infection in her leg.
What was that?
She's in the emergency room right now. They think she has a staph infection in her leg.
Oh, she's in the emergency room. As we speak, they believe she has a staph infection. So please pray for Ella. Any other concerns or joys? Yes. What was that, Helen? Prayers Thursday, Helen Holland. Carotid artery. She showed me pictures of the previous surgery. No one to see these. Those are something. Andrew. School is out. Yes, that's a joy. I think all the teachers are also applauding that one. Any other concerns or joys? Seeing none others, let us bow our heads in a word of prayer. Most gracious God, we do thank you again for this beautiful and glorious morning that you have given to us. We thank you for this beautiful weather. We thank you that the summer is almost here. And dear God, we just thank you for all that you do for us. I just thank you for all the teachers in our midst and for their sacrifice this past year, and that they're able to recoup this summer, hopefully. And dear God, for all of the kiddos, we just, as they are home, we pray that you'll protect them. We pray that your anointing touch will be upon them. Dear God, I also thank you for all of our veterans, not only here, but around this nation of ours. I thank you for their service. And dear God, I especially remember those who gave their lives during times of war for our freedoms, for the ability to come here this morning to worship you with freedom, with those rights that we have been given. And so, dear God, we know our nation is not perfect. So forgive us when we fall short. But, dear God, in those ways that we show the presence of Christ, for those ways in which we show his sacrifice, we thank you. We thank you for the millions who have done that. Dear God, I pray for all of the prayers that have been mentioned this morning for Helen and surgery, for Ella as she's in the emergency room. For others, dear God, we just pray that you'll anoint them. For Mosun, we pray that you'll give her full recovery. Dear God, I pray for the families who have lost loved ones, and so for the Marv Miller family, for the Kelly Nielsen family. Dear God, I pray that you'll support them as only you can, that you'll hold them gently in the palm of your hand, that your anointing touch will be upon them. And dear God, that you will give to them exactly what they need today. Dear God, we just thank you for what you do in our lives, and I pray for each and every person here in this service. Dear God, I pray that you will anoint us, that you will bless us, that we may be your witnesses in this world, that we may be the army of the Lord, but our weapon is prayer. Our weapon is peace and love, and so give us the strength to be your people in the world around us. But dear God, we just thank you for all that you do for us. Again, we thank you for this beautiful day and for this time of worship. Dear God, it is our privilege and joy to be able to join together in the prayer that Christ Jesus taught us. So I invite everyone to join along with me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Over this weekend and seeing those veteran gravestones that are decorated and cleansed and seeing all the flags out there. It's just what a wonderful time it is for our nation. You might know this, you've got a bulletin, you've probably seen it online, but we as a church, there's another holiday we celebrate today. It's not a national holiday, but it is a Christian holiday, and I think it is a holiday with great significance, and that holiday is Pentecost. Very good. I almost said Pentagon. I've got the military on my mind. Pentecost, Penta 50, and so Pentecost is the 50 days in the Jewish holiday, 50 days after Passover and the Christian church. It's 50 days after Easter. And so today we are celebrating Pentecost. Because it is 50 days after Easter, it always is a little different every year depending on when Easter is. But today is Pentecost. Now, usually Pentecost kind of comes and goes without any fanfare. I mean, typically you don't give a greeting card for Pentecost. Anybody ever receive a Pentecost greeting card? If you ever see one in the store, purchase it, buy it, I will pay you back. I want to see a Pentecost greeting card. We don't throw parties for Pentecost. We don't even have a cake, even though in the church we consider this the birthday of the church, the day upon which God gave to every believer and still gives every believer the power of the Holy Spirit. But we don't have birthday parties for Pentecost. So maybe today, you know, I don't know, celebrate Pentecost, sing happy birthday to the church, to the power of the Holy Spirit. But again, even though a lot of times it comes and goes, I think it is just as important as the big two in the Christian church. I think it's just as important as Christmas and Easter. As a matter of fact, I believe Christmas and Easter are incomplete without the celebration of Pentecost. We need Pentecost in our lives. In the Gospel of Luke, before Jesus ascends into heaven, he instructs his disciples to stay in Jerusalem until they receive, and I quote, power from on high. That's what Pentecost does. That's what the Holy Spirit does. It gives us power from on high. And as much as we need the cross, as much as we need the forgiveness of sins, I'm just going to let those papers just fly for right now. As much as we need the cross, as much as we need the forgiveness of sins, as much as we need Easter and the empty tomb and the victory that we were given with Easter, just as much as we need those two things, we need Pentecost. We need the power of the Holy Spirit. Thank you so much. We need the power of the Holy Spirit. We need power, right? You know?
Panic.
I don't even know what that's called. What's that called, Spencer? The receiver? The receiver! You know, the receiver, even though that's a perfectly fine receiver, right? There's nothing mechanically wrong with that receiver. That receiver works. It works well. I mean, I think it sounds great. But even though there's no problem with that receiver, it still needs what?
Power.
It still needs power. And for us, even though we are followers of Jesus Christ, which means we've been forgiven, which means we've been made anew, which means that there is nothing wrong with us. We have been forgiven of our sins. Even though all of that has been given to us, there's still something we need, and it is
power.
It's the power of the Holy Spirit. I once read this, and I forget, and I have lost whoever first said this. I've seen many people repeat it, but I'll just be honest, I am not sure who originally said this. But someone once wrote, the average Christian and the average church are somewhere bogged down between Calvary, the cross, and Pentecost. They have been to Calvary, they've been to the cross for pardon, but they have not been to Pentecost for power. Bethlehem means God with us. Emmanuel, Jesus, born, God with us. Calvary, the cross, means God for us, but Pentecost means God in us. Pentecost means God in us, the power of Pentecost. And so this morning I want to look really quickly through Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 13. So if you have your phones, you can follow along. If you brought your Bibles, Acts chapter 2, and I'm kind of going to go through those verses 1 through 13. Acts chapter 2, verse 1. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Now the they that Luke is talking about here are the followers of Jesus Christ. So all of the followers of Christ were together on the day of Pentecost. And again, this was both a Jewish and Christian holiday. In the Jewish faith, this holiday celebrated the wheat harvest as well as give the giving of the law to Moses on Mount Sinai. So that's what the Jewish faith celebrates on the day of Pentecost. That's what the followers of Jesus were celebrating on the day of Pentecost. Remember, they were Jews. So on the day of Pentecost, they were together in Jerusalem. They would have been celebrating Pentecost, the Jewish holiday, the wheat harvest, the giving of the law to Moses. That's what they would have been celebrating on the day of Pentecost. Little did they know that God was going to bring Pentecost to a completion in a sense, and that no longer did we need the law given to Moses, because now we have the Holy Spirit being given to every believer who follows Jesus Christ. So we have the Holy Spirit on our hearts. We have the law, if you will, the law inside of us. The power of the Holy Spirit leading us and guiding us. And so as they were together celebrating the Jewish festival of Pentecost, God was about to do something new. So in verse 2, suddenly a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. So as the disciples were gathered together in this room, this house, 120 of them, suddenly this sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. Now when you read the Bible, and all of a sudden you start hearing about a powerful wind or a violent wind, you know that God is up to something. In Genesis chapter 8, verse 1, we are told that it was a wind that cleared the floodwaters on this earth so that Noah and his family could escape the ark. In Numbers 11:31, it was a strong wind that brought quail to the Israelites. Remember, the Israelites were out in the wilderness, kind of lost, hungry. They had just escaped from the clutches of Pharaoh. And what does God do? God brings them manna from heaven. God feeds them this miraculous bread. But the people of Israel were just a bunch of knuckleheads. So God rescues them. God saves them. Now they're in the wilderness. God miraculously gives them bread from heaven. God gives them manna. But it's not enough. They complain. Now they have enough to be nourished, but they complain. And they say, God, we want a little variety. And so God is a generous God. God is a loving God. And so God says, okay. And so God brings to them quail. And how does God do that? Through a strong wind. A few weeks back, we looked at Ezekiel in the Valley of Dry Bones and how the breath of God, the Spirit of God, was breathed upon the bones and the bones came back to life. But do you remember how that breath was brought to the bones? It was brought by the four winds, from the winds of the earth. Whenever you hear about a strong wind in the Bible, God is up to something. And in here, God is bringing to them the power of the Holy Spirit. Verses 3 through 4. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. You know, one thing that separates humanity from the rest of the animals on the face of this earth is the ability for us to harness fire. To harness fire. Remember back in the day, before there were generators, before there was electricity, how did people keep themselves warm? They built a fire. How did they kill all the bacteria in the water? They boiled it on fire. How did they protect themselves at night from the wild beasts around them? They built a fire. Not only does fire provide protection and beauty and warmth, but I think there is just something awe-inspiring about fire. I love this time of year. I love campfires. Who loves a good campfire? You know, not only, man, that's not even half of y'all. Every hand. I mean, two hands, campfires. Not only do you get roast marshmallows and hot dogs, but I think there's just something mesmerizing about a campfire, the crackling and popping of the wood. You've got the fire, you've got the sparks, you've got the smoke rising into the heavens. There's just something mesmerizing about a campfire. When I'm around a campfire, I can't take my eyes off of it. Now, obviously, you can misuse fire, right? When I was a little kid, my younger brother actually set the garage on fire. It didn't go too far. They were able to put it out, but there's just something mesmerizing about fire. And for us, in many ways, fire represents life. Again, it's protection. It's warmth. We need fire in our lives, and no wonder that in the Old Testament, God appeared to Moses through a burning bush. In our text, God's Holy Spirit appears as tongues of fire that descends upon all of the believers. And with that, they were anointed and were able to speak in other tongues, as our text tells us. Now, that word in Greek, tongue, here in Acts, it literally means your tongue. The tongue in your mouth. That's the word that's used. But really what it means is languages. And so they were able to speak in other tongues. They were able to speak in other languages. And notice who was given this anointing. Who was given the power of the Holy Spirit? It was all of the believers. All 120 believers were given the anointing of the Holy Spirit. And from that day on, every believer, everyone who accepts Jesus Christ into their heart, is given the power of the Holy Spirit. If you're a believer here today, you have been given the Holy Spirit. If you've been baptized, if you've confessed your sins, you have been given the power of the Holy Spirit. That's why we call this the birthday of the church. Prior to this day, some 2,000 years ago, there was only a special elected people who were given this anointing. But now all believers are given the anointing of the Holy Spirit. It is the birthday of the church. Going on to verses 5 through 13. Now there were staying in Jerusalem God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. Again, they were there because of the Jewish celebration of Pentecost. When they heard this sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment because each one heard their own language being spoken. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Aren't all these who are speaking Galileans? Then how is it that each of us hears them in our native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya near Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs, we hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues." Amazed and perplexed, they asked one another, "What does this mean?" Some, however, made fun of them and said they have had too much wine. Now, I love Luke's account here, and I love that last line that Luke gives us. He didn't have to write that, but he does. He said in the midst of all of this, there were some people making fun of the Christians and thought that they were drunk. Now, why would they think that the followers of Christ here were drunk? I don't think it's because they were speaking in other languages. Everybody heard them speaking in their own language. Why would you make fun of someone speaking in your language? I mean, if someone from Africa was here this morning and they started speaking to me in English, you know, I would be in awe of them. I wouldn't make fun of them. So I don't think that's why they were being made fun of. No, I think they were being made fun of because I don't think they could contain the joy and the zeal in their hearts to share this that God had just given to them. So they were so joyous, so full of zeal about sharing that they seemed a little crazy. Not only that, but let's just say it's French. I barely speak English, much less a foreign language. But let's just say I could speak French. Let's say I was in France, and all of a sudden, out of nowhere, I had never spoken French before in my life. But imagine if all of a sudden, I was anointed and I could speak French. I'd be telling everybody, "Hey, let me talk to you in French, because up until this day, I could never speak it before." Now if I said that to somebody, that I had never spoken your language before, but now all of a sudden these what appeared to be tongues of fire came and rested upon me, now I can speak your language. You know, if you said that to me, I might think you're a little drunk. I might think you're a little crazy. It sounds crazy, right? It sounds ridiculous. But I think that's why the other people were thinking that they were a little nuts, a little crazy, because I don't think the Christians could contain their joy, their zeal. And what it tells us is they were telling everyone they could share with the wonders of God. They couldn't contain the joy and the zeal of sharing what the wonders of God, which on that particular day was this anointing from the Spirit that suddenly enabled them to speak in other languages. This is not the only place in the Bible where God's people appear to be a little crazy, a little nuts, a little zealous for the Lord. I think back to 2 Samuel chapter 6. And here King David is leading a procession into Jerusalem, and they've got the Ark of the Covenant with them. And remember the Ark, it's got the Ten Commandments, it's the whole Indiana Jones franchise, which I think they're coming out with a new Indiana Jones. So I'm looking forward to that. So that's the Ark of the Covenant. They're bringing the Ark of the Covenant into Jerusalem. David is leading this procession, and we are told that David is dancing. David is dancing. David's being a little joyous, a little zealous for the Lord. He is dancing as the ark is being led into the city. And there were some who complained that the king was dancing in front of the ark. Can you imagine Joe Biden dancing one day, or whoever? I'm not picking out Joe Biden, but any of our presidents. I don't know. People complained. Why is David dancing? And this was David's reply. I will celebrate before the Lord. I will become even more undignified than this. The joy he had for God, the joy he had for his Lord was so great he could not contain it. He had to dance. And David said, I will celebrate before God. I will become even more undignified than this. In Paul's letter to the Corinthians, 2 Corinthians 5:13, Paul says, if we are crazy, it's for God's sake. If we are crazy, if we appear to be crazy, if we appear to be out of our minds, it is for God's sake. Now last week we concluded a six-week sermon series on the power of revival. So here's a little postscript for you after spending 6 weeks. And by the way, again, I'm looking for people, if you want to be on a team to look at how we can be intentional about bringing revival to Faith Church and to our community, please see me as we look at putting this team together. But a little postscript from the end of that sermon series. If we want revival in our church, if we want revival in our community, if we want revival in our world, then we're gonna have to be a little crazy. We're gonna have to be a little undignified in declaring the wonders of God. When we share with God, those God sightings in our life, when we share with so we thank Charles, and Charles is one of our veterans too, and so we appreciate Charles. So. So again, we're going to have to get a little crazy, a little undignified in declaring the wonders of God, and obviously that's going to be different for all of us, right? Whether you're an extrovert, introvert, it's going to be different what it means to be a little crazy for the Lord. My roommate from seminary, who's a pastor, Carrie Thrush, was much more and is much more extroverted than I am. I mean, Carrie's one of those guys, he would have been out front literally dancing before the Lord. Me, I'm not sure I'd be that undignified. But it's going to be different for all of us what it means to be a little crazy, to be a little undignified for the Lord. Whether you're an extrovert, introvert, your personality, it's going to be a little different. But here's my challenge for all of us. If we want revival, all of us, it takes the full body. All of us are going to have to share God's sightings. All of us are going to have to share the wonders of God to those around us, whether it's family members, friends, you know, the person who serves you your lunch or your dinner at a restaurant. Maybe that's just a smile, or you're seeing that they're having a rough day, and so you pray for them. It's posting on Facebook, it's going to Instagram, it's sharing with your neighbor when you see them out in the yard. It is sharing what God has done in your life. And so I want to encourage you in your everyday lives, right? Think about think about revival, as we pray for revival in our lives, get up every morning and just ask God to show you how you can share His wonders in the world today. Again, it could be with a family member, a friend, a coworker, a fellow student, a neighbor. But how am I going to share the wonders of God around us? Because that's exactly what the church does when we are filled with the Holy Spirit. When God is in us, that is what we do. We share the wonders of God. Would you please pray with me? Most gracious God, we thank you for this day. I pray for Charles and just ask that you bless him. And dear God, we just thank you for him and for all of our veterans here today. But dear God, as we think about the community around us, as we think about our nation, as we think about our world, dear God, we are in a fight against the spiritual forces of evil. Dear God, they are all around us, and we can't always see them, but we know we are in this battle, this spiritual battle for lost souls, for people who do not know you. And so, dear God, just give us the courage. I just pray for your anointing to be upon each and every one of us today, that as we go out into the world, that we can declare your wonders. We can declare the sightings that we have seen, where you have been, what you have done, what you are saying to us. But dear God, we thank you for the freedom that we have to do that. We thank you for this anointing, and we thank you for this gift of being able to be the people who share the gospel of Christ to those around us. But dear Lord, we just thank you for all these things. Again, anoint each and every one of us with the power of the Holy Spirit. As in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I invite you to join with us as we sing our last song. Am I standing in prayer? it takes a lot to get everything out here, so I just thank Spencer and his team who did all of that for us this morning. And again, thank you for being here today. Let's give them a hand. I invite you back next week. We have our normal service times, 8:30 and 10:45, and we also will be celebrating communion next week. And if anybody needs prayer, are you praying, Lisa? Lisa Meredith is here, and she would love to pray with you this morning. But now may the love of God, the grace and peace of Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the entire church be with each and every one of you. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. God bless. Have a wonderful, blessed weekend.
Before you depart, it was asked that we sing Happy Birthday for the church. So please raise your voices.
Happy birthday to you.